So in the previous segment, we established how to build complex quantum systems from simpler parts that we compose into a larger system. We saw that defining the quantum state of a composite system isn't that difficult, and the observables of each part have a very distinct structure. But we also saw that something very interesting is hidden behind the probabilities of measurements on the different parts, namely entanglement. In the remainder of this chapter, we are going to further establish the physical consequences of this. We do this in two steps, where we are guided by two questions, namely, what can we learn about a quantum system when we have access to only a part of it, and how do the different parts of a quantum system then influence each other? This has a broader context beyond the consideration of entanglement. The state of a composite system can have a very large number of relevant components, which contain a rather overwhelming amount of information. Indeed, much of this may encode information about properties of the system that aren't interesting or even accessible to us. In many situations, it may not even be clear how to draw the line for physical objects that we want to include into our description. And also in this context, we would ask the very same questions, namely, what can we learn from a quantum system by making observations on just a part of it, and how do different parts of a quantum system influence each other? As it happens, these questions are strongly interlinked, and they can both be answered with the help of a new powerful concept. This is the density matrix, which is a more generalized notion of a quantum state. The upshot will be that this density matrix can be used to describe all physical properties of a subsystem, even when it is entangled with the remainder of the system. But this entanglement leaves a very clear signature in the density matrix, which has a very interesting and concrete physical interpretation. So what we are going to do next is to introduce this density matrix in general terms, and later we are going to utilize it to get a better understanding of entanglement. In short, the density matrix describes a statistical ensemble of quantum states for a given system, accounting for the possibility that we might not know exactly which of the different states the system is in. To see how this goes, we first clarify what we mean by a statistical ensemble, and then we derive the density matrix from this. We start out with a collection of quantum states psi indexed by an index I. And to each of these states, we are going to assign a certain probability pi. So we have these pairs of states and probabilities. And what we say is that each of these states may apply to our quantum system, but we do not know exactly which of the states it is in, we only know the probabilities of this. We further assume that all the quantum states in this ensemble are normalized, and also that all the probabilities in here add up to 1. And so this already defines what we mean by a statistical ensemble. These probabilities in here can be of any origin, they just capture some incomplete information of the state, and this has a very wide range of applications. For instance, we could have a set of quantum systems which are all of the same type. So we might have many copies of the same quantum system, such as maybe atoms in a gas. And they can all be in different physical states, perhaps because we are talking about the system at a given temperature. Considerations such as this form the basis of statistical mechanics, where we would assign the probabilities according to the Boltzmann weights, depending also on the energy of the states. And this in turn provides the foundations for thermodynamics built up from a quantum mechanical perspective. We will indeed return to this application in the next chapter. Another setting could be that we carry out a measurement, but we do not record the values of the measurement outcomes. Well, it could actually be that something like a measurement is just carried out by something in the environment that we just don't have access to or no control of. So we have the situation where the quantum system is going to be forced into one of the eigenstates according to the observation that is being carried out, but we have no way to find out which of the observable values this corresponds to. The only thing that we know are the different probabilities with which this occurs. Indeed, this can be viewed as a composite system, and we are looking at just a part of it, namely we have our quantum system that we are interested in, but ignore what has happened to the wider environment that is carrying out this sort of measurement. And this perspective then also allows us to consider open systems. So these are just a few possible applications. And as mentioned above, here we indeed want to eventually utilize this concept to see how we can describe just a part of a composite system, and thereby explore how the different parts of the system are correlated with each other. Now, to fix some useful notions, the case that we dealt with so far was a system where we assume that we know the state. This would now correspond to a situation where just one of these probabilities is 1 and all the others vanish. We call such ensembles pure ensembles. In all other cases, we call the ensemble mixed. And whatever we will do in the following, we will certainly want to make sure that we just replicate the quantum mechanics we are familiar with when we have a pure ensemble, and then we want to generalize this naturally to the case of a mixed ensemble. Given that we now have some additional probabilities, the natural starting point is to look at the average outcomes of observations on a certain observable A. If we have a well-defined quantum state psi I, then this would just be our conventional expectation value. But when we do not know which quantum state our system is in, we also have to average this further using the probabilities that the system is indeed in this state. So this is a very natural generalization of the expectation value to the case that we do not quite know in which of the quantum states our system is in. And now we can rewrite this in a very convenient form by introducing a formal trick. And we just need it in the derivation. At the end, we will get a useful and relatively simple result. What we are going to do is to introduce the identity operator at a suitable point, as indicated here. As you recall, we can write the identity operator in any orthonormal basis as this diagonal sum over the basis states. So then we have here a sum over both indices, in which we have these probabilities pi, the scalar product between the states psi I and n, and a scalar product also involving the operator A, so basically a matrix element. These are all numbers, and we can just interchange the order of these numbers in a convenient way. And now we see that we can write this also in the following form, where we pull the two sums apart and use the power of the Dirac notation. Then we can make two observations. First of all, we have this sum here carried out in a certain orthonormal basis of states n. But which basis we are using was not specified, and so this should give the same answer in any orthonormal basis. What this does is to look at everything which is in the middle, which is a certain operator, and sum over all its diagonal matrix elements. These are the matrix elements where the same index is applied to the row and the column. Now, this is a very standard operation on matrices and operators and is known as the trace. Secondly, the operator that we apply this to is the product of the observable A and a new operator, which only contains information about the ensemble and that therefore encodes all the physically relevant information this contains. And this operator, denoted here as rho, we call the density matrix. This operator is given, as stated, as a sum with these probabilities and the quantum states. So instead of working with these individual quantum states, we now have an operator that describes the whole collection of these states. And this suffices to determine all the expectation values in this more general situation. This expression for the density matrix and the rule how we can determine expectation values from it are two central results of this segment. This operator will look a little bit unfamiliar when you see it for the first time, but it is extremely powerful and has a range of really nice properties, so that we can work with it almost as easily as with a normal state while capturing a much larger range of physical phenomena. For instance, the trace of rho itself is just 1. And this is just a more general version of the normalization condition. Also, this operator is Hermitian, and hence all its eigenvalues are real. I'm going to denote these eigenvalues as capital Pi and the corresponding eigenstates as phi I, so that we can write the density matrix also in the following diagonal form. But this itself looks like the very definition of a density matrix, where these eigenvalues are interpreted as probabilities for the corresponding eigenstates. And thereby, they all turn out to be non-negative and add up to 1. Now, the key idea of the density matrix is that it generalizes the notion of a quantum state, but for a pure ensemble, this should just be equivalent to the description with a normal quantum state. The density matrix then takes a very simple form as given here, and we call this a pure state. And when we work out an expectation value with this, then by just retracing our steps in the derivation, this will indeed be identical to the conventional expectation value evaluated in this specific state. Now, it would be nice if we had an easy way to figure out that we are dealing with such a pure state, because we can then do our calculations in this conventional way. And this can be done by realizing that in this case, rho squared equals 2 rho. And so when we take the trace of rho squared in a pure state, we get the trace of rho, which by normalization is just 1. In all other situations where this is not the case, so for mixed ensembles, we say that the density matrix describes a mixed state. And in such a mixed state, the trace of rho squared will indeed be less than 1. We call this quantity the purity, as it quantifies how close our state is to a pure state. This works out because when we take a trace of an operator, then we get the sum of its eigenvalues. Now, the eigenvalues of the square of an operator are just the squares of the eigenvalues, and so we can write the purity also as the sum of the squared eigenvalues of rho. But because these are numbers between 0 and 1, this will in general always be less than the result that we obtain when we replace the squares by the numbers themselves. But this sum was just 1. And this value is only attained when exactly one of these probabilities is 1 and all the others vanish. There's also a well-defined maximally mixed state, which is the one where all the states occur with the same probability. The density matrix is then the identity matrix divided by the number of independent states, hence the Hilbert space dimension, let's denote it as n. This then has the smallest purity, which is indeed the inverse of the Hilbert space dimension. So we have a very important distinction between two different types of statistical ensembles and corresponding states, pure states and mixed states. In pure states, we can work out quantum mechanics just in the way that we are familiar with a quantum state in a Hilbert space, and in mixed states we have a more generalized situation where we do not quite know in which of the quantum states the system is in, and for this we need the density matrix. In terms of definitions, this distinction is independent of our earlier distinction of states as separable or entangled, but in our examples we will see that these two distinctions indeed eliminate each other. So what else do we need to carry out quantum mechanics in this more general way? In terms of our observables, nothing has changed, and for measurements we are also covered, as we already worked out what we mean by expectation values. The only thing that is left is the dynamics. For this we need to know how the density matrix changes over time, and this we obtain from the Schrödinger equation. Indeed, in the temporal derivative of rho we find two terms involving the derivative of the states and their duals, and in both we can use the Schrödinger equation. This gives us a multiplication by the Hamiltonian from the left or right, with a relative minus sign because of the complex conjugation of the imaginary unit when we apply this to the dual states. This of course just defines the commutator. So our final result can be written in this form here. This is known as the von Neumann-Liouville equation. Incidentally, it looks a little bit like the equations of motion in the Heisenberg picture, but it actually differs by a minus sign. Indeed, here we still work in the Schrödinger picture, and this simply replaces the Schrödinger equation. As before, the dynamics is still generated by the Hamiltonian. This completes our discussion of the definition and the most important general properties of the density matrix. Next, we turn to a simple example, because in practice it is not as complicated as it might look from these abstract definitions. So to see how the density matrix works in practice, we turn to the example of a single two-level system. We start with a system in a certain state of the form given here, which we assume to be normalized. And first have a look at the density matrix when we deal with the corresponding pure state. I'm going to carry this out in our two different languages using the Dirac notation and with vectors and matrices, where we will see how simple this actually will be. So first of all, in terms of the Dirac notation, the corresponding density matrix just looks as specified here. When we multiply this out, we can read off the corresponding matrix as given here. And as indicated, this can also be obtained directly from the multiplication of the state vector by its Hermitian conjugate. We see that the result is a Hermitian matrix, and the sum of the diagonals is just 1 by the normalization condition. So this already covers the case of a pure state for this two-level system. Now for a mixed state, rho is a sum of such states, but each of these just looks like a density matrix of a pure state as defined here. What we end up with is still a Hermitian matrix. Now, as we have utilized a number of times before, we can write any such matrix as the sum of the identity matrix and the three Pauli matrices, where all the coefficients A, B, C, and D are real numbers. Now we can work out the expectation values for the corresponding four different observables, and we will get a very simple result in each case. This is because the trace of this identity matrix is 2, the trace of the Pauli matrices vanishes, the square of any Pauli matrix is the identity matrix, and the product of two different Pauli matrices is just another Pauli matrix. And with this, we find that these expectation values just give us each of these four coefficients multiplied by 2, where this factor of 2 comes from the trace of the 2x2 identity matrix. Moreover, the first expectation value here is just our normalization condition, so we have to set A to 1/2. As before, we can group the remaining expectation values into a vector, the polarization vector, with components Px, Py, and Pz. And so in turn, we can now express the density matrix in terms of the components of this vector. Now we see in a very concrete way that this polarization vector indeed captures all the physically relevant information of the quantum state, even when this is a mixed state. Well, for a pure state, the polarization vector was of unit length, but we now see that for a mixed state, this is no longer the case. In particular, when we look at a maximally mixed state for this two-level system here, then this would just be 1/2 times the identity matrix. And this corresponds to the case where the polarization vector vanishes. Indeed, there is a very direct and simple relation between the length of this polarization vector and the purity of the system. We obtain this directly from the definition of the purity, where we can insert the density matrix as the 2x2 matrix given before. This gives us the stated result, which we can write in terms of the length of the polarization vector as given here. So far for this illustration of the general features of the density matrix. In the next segment, we see how we can utilize it specifically to describe a part of a composite quantum system, and how this reveals the physical implications of entanglement.